So this presentation tries to make a link between the ESD protection on one hand and leakage power consumption on the other hand. It's focused on SOI applications. As an IC, through the eyes of an ESD engineer, you get a very simplified schematic like this. You have some inputs, some outputs, in this case represented by some inverter stage. You have a VDD line, a ground line, and in between all these things you have some circuitry which we simplified call a core. Of course, in many applications, if not all applications, there are multiple VDD lines, multiple ground lines, and for sure more in and outputs than schematically represented here. And also in the remainder of the presentation, you'll note that the in and outputs will be taken together as an I/O and will take abstraction of the circuitry behind it. Now you see all the different green blocks, they indicate clamps or diodes for ESD protection. In the presentation will focus on these blocks. If we look at an I/O as represented here, again, you see the three ESD clamps or diodes being placed. And there are three leakage paths which we have to take into account. Of course, there's the I/O to ground. Next to that, you also have the I/O versus VDD and the VDD to ground. Of course, especially for the I/O to VDD, the arrow could be drawn in the other direction as well. We look a bit at it as the leakage being positive from the I/O either to ground or to VDD or both. Now there are multiple architectures for ESD to replace the green blocks. Three of them are shown here, and these I think are the three we will talk most about in this presentation. So on the left hand you have the typical dual diode system where ESD current flows through either of the diodes and through the power clamp to shun away the stress case. Other examples, the middle one, is where you have some secondary protection. So there's some resistance and then a clamp. We'll talk about the implementation of the clamp later between the I/O and VDD and ground. Or the third case, where the diode between I/O and VDD is omitted and you only have protection from ground to I/O through a diode and a local protection from I/O to ground as well. Of course, it's easy to see already that these three cases represent a totally different story when it comes to leakage. So let's have a look at the first one. From an ESD point of view, this is quite straightforward. It's the simplest architecture, but you do need a fairly large design window. So this means that the I/O itself must be fairly strong to withstand some voltage during ESD. So when you zap from I/O to ground, in this case, the current will flow through the diode between I/O and VDD, and then through a power clamp to ground. Taking into account all bus resistances, this means that between I/O and ground, there is quite a lot of voltage being built up, and therefore the design window for ESD has to be fairly large. From a signal point of view, the implications of this type of protection mean that the I/O voltage has to be larger than ground, let's say minus 0.3 volts, and smaller than VDD, again with some 0.3 volt margin. The 0.3 is the voltage that you can build up over diode without a significant current flow, of course. This can depend a bit on application to application, how much voltage can be, or how much current can be tolerated. Leakage at the I/O is extremely low in this case, because both diodes, if the I/O is in a voltage somewhere in between ground and VDD, then the voltage over the diodes is always in reverse. The diode is always in reverse, and a reverse junction of a diode between I/O and ground or between I/O and VDD, this reverse diode will not conduct a large current. Current will be small. Between VDD and ground, it's of course completely determined by the power clamp. Now, if you look at SOI, on the top left, you see the typical STI diode in bulk, but you cannot easily translate that to a diode in SOI because of the Baird oxide basically blocking the path where the current should flow from anode to cathode. Now, in bulk, you can construct a gated diode where the STI between anode and diode is gone, is away, and you only have a gate on top of that, basically to block the STI during processing. This type of diode, this can be translated to SOI as you see on the bottom right. And this is a diode we will talk about now in the further slides as well. The main difference between bulk and SOI, actually there are two main differences. One is in bulk, there is much, much more room, much more volume to dissipate heat. That translates in ESD to the fact that the forward and also the reverse, but especially the forward current, is an order of magnitude larger as compared to an SOI diode. In SOI diode, if you have a forward conduction of, let's say, 5 to 10 milliamps per micrometer, you have a pretty decent diode. In bulk, you can expect this to be 20 to 50 milliamps per micrometer. The second big difference is, in bulk, you have a lot of parasitics. For instance, anode to substrate, through the N-well, you see there's a PNP, which will shunt current to the substrate when the diode is in conducting mode. Also, between the substrate and the cathode, there's always a diode as well. In SOI, all these parasitics are gone. This can have advantages, also some disadvantages for ESD. If you compare the measurements, you see they might look very similar, except that on the y-axis, where the current is plotted, you see for the 65 nanometer bulk diode, it goes to about 3 amperes, and for the SOI diode, 65 nanometer SOI diode, it goes to about 700 milliamp. Translating to 33 milliamps per micrometer for the bulk diode and maybe 9 to 10 milliamps per micrometer for the SOI diode. I should note that in the presentation we'll mix different SOI technologies just to show that all these trends are not restricted to one specific technology. This is an example for 65 nanometer technologies. Now, when it comes to leakage, as said before, we have to look at the reverse diode. And you can see that leakage is really, really low. It's in the order of, let's say, 100 picoamp at room temperature, maybe a bit higher at higher temperatures, but still it's quite or extremely low. Note also that the noise on the high voltage, the high temperature measurement is just because it was measured on our old thermochock that quite induced quite a lot of noise. That is the leakage story for the dual diode protection. At the I/O itself, there is hardly any leakage. Let's say 10 picoamps at 1.8 volts for 25 degrees, a few hundred picoamps at 125 degrees. So now let's look at the second case where you not only have the dual diodes, but you have some secondary protection behind the resistance. The idea is that the majority of the current still flows to a dual diode, and that the secondary protection only takes a small portion of the current, but limits the voltage over the I/O circuitry dramatically. Again, from an ESD point of view, the architecture is quite simple and very well known in the industry. The secondary protection stage can be very small. It can be maybe 10, 20, 30 micrometers in total width. It only has to take, let's say, 50 milliamps of current, order of magnitude, maybe 100 milliamps of current, depending on the design window and the size of the resistance. But because you use this secondary stage, it's easier to protect for very small design windows. And it also helps quite a lot for CDM, because the large CDM current flows through dual diodes, and the voltage is limited by the secondary protection. And because you separate the large current from the voltage being built up, it makes it easier for CDM to protect. CDM, you have to take into account typically is much higher currents than HBM. HBM 2 kilovolt, HBM being about 1.3 amps of current, while CDM can easily be 5, 6, 7, 8 amps of current, depending on the size of your package. The implications for the signal voltage is exactly the same as with the dual diode protection. Again, the signal has to remain between ground minus 0.3 volts and VDD plus about 0.3 volts. Now for the leakage, the first path is the same to the reverse diode, but then of course there's now a secondary path through the resistance and through the secondary clamp. Now in the following slides, we will assume the clamp to be a small NMOS device with a gate coupled to ground to the source of that NMOS. So maybe as an interlude, very shortly, how does this behave? Let's take a bulk technology and just have a look at how this GG NMOS behaves during DSD. Now first, as the gate is grounded and the voltage increases, there's basically no current flow because the MOS is in off state. If you go to point two, you see in the drawing, there's some an explosion, let's say, at the drain side. This is avalanching, or if it increases, impact ionization, where there's a break down of the reverse diode N plus P well, P substrate, some current flows, and if the current increases, we call this impact ionization. This current will flow from the drain to ground. Now, in the cross section in point three, you see that there is some resistance drawn in the substrate. Every substrate has some resistance, and over this resistance, the current will build up some voltage. And at a certain point in time, there will be about 0.7 volts between the substrate and the source. Now, this is, of course, the base emitter junction of this parasitic NPN, which is residing between drain, P well, and source. And this parasitic NPN will start to draw current. Now, when this NPN starts to draw current, the beta of the NPN will basically kick in and will allow the voltage over the drain source to be lowered and still sustain a higher current. That's basically the function of beta, the current multiplication. And you'll see in the IV curve, you have what we call a snapback effect, where the voltage drops and the current increases. This is the basic principle of how an NMOS in snapback works. Now, if we look at the SOI technology, or first this one, the previous drawings were one finger devices. If we look at multiple finger devices, you'll note that the drain of the middle finger will, the current through that drain will help also to forward bias the sources close to the guard band. In other words, the different fingers help each other because the full substrate is lifted by this avalanching current. Now, if we look at an SOI technology, there is this buried oxide below drain and source, and that causes all these bases of these, all these parasitic NPNs to be isolated from each other. Which means that if one finger goes into avalanching, goes into snapback, the other fingers know nothing about that. They don't feel the substrate being lifted, as was the case for NMOS in bulk technologies. If you compare the measurements, again, you'll see the amount of current you can shunt to an NMOS in bulk is much higher than you can shunt to an NMOS in SOI. In this case, in 90 nanometer technologies, the SOI performance was about 2.4 milliamps per micrometer, and that is already a pretty good performance. It's not rare to see lower performances, 1, 1.5 milliamps per micrometer in these SOI technologies. In bulk technologies, typically it's something between 5 to 10 milliamps of micrometers. In this 90 nanometer bulk process, it turned out to be 6 milliamp per micrometer. If you look at the trigger and holding voltages, so the points where the, in the IV curve where the current starts to increase, Typically, they're a bit smaller in SOI as compared to bulk. Now, there are two issues with these MOS devices in SOI, and the first one is degradation. This is something we have seen not in all SOI technologies, but in a lot of them. You can see at the right, there's a leakage curves. And the way these TLP curves are built up, it's a lot of different pulses going from very small to very large pulses. And the IV curve is a construction made between all these different measurement points. So each TLP curve represents maybe 100 different measurements. And between all these measurement points, the leakage is measured to see that the device has not degraded, has not changed in any way. But in this SOI technology, very often you will see that the leakage starts to deviate measurement after measurement after measurement. This means the device is slowly degrading. Another issue we often see in SOI MOS devices is variation. This is actually a solution which was proposed by the foundry as in their PDK as a solution for the process. And they showed some measurement and it showed good results. As you can see in the green, the dark blue, the light blue curve, at 1.8 amps of current, it should be a good 2 kilovolt HPM device. Now, when we did the measurements in our lab and we measured multiple samples, we saw that some of the samples had good performance was indicated in the PDK as well. But other devices, same layout, just a different die, sometimes a different corner, there the device failed immediately. And this type of variation, it's not uncommon in SOI technologies. You might have similar things in bulk technology, but it's rarely as pronounced as it is in SOI technology. So these two reasons, the degradation and the variation, it makes us at least reluctant to rely on GGNMOS devices in SOI technologies, at least reluctant if we had didn't have the opportunity to test them extensively in our lab to make sure everything is okay. Okay, so let's look at the third option, where there is no diode between I/O and VDD, only between ground and I/O, and then some local clamp between I/O and ground. So if we look at some possible protection devices, this is an SCR based power clamp or local clamp in a 1.2 volt domain in 90 nanometer. You see that it can withstand quite a lot of current, about 1.8 amps for not that big device, 240 micrometer. And maximum current we would allow through the clamp of 7.5 milliamps per micrometer, which is really not bad in SOI technology. If we look at the leakage in this case, it would have been it would be 0.5 nanoamps for 25 degrees. So it is possible, even with a local protection, to have the leakage significantly below 1 nanoamp, at least at room temperature. If we go further, this is some measurements in a 22 nanometer SOI technology, again with SCR based clamp. You see on the left hand leakage plots for 25 degrees and 125 degrees for a 0.8 volt clamp and or for a 1.2 to 1.8 volt clamp. These are actual measurements, it's not simulation. And you can see it for the different voltage ranges. The leakage still remains significantly below 1 nanoamp for room temperature. For 125 degrees, it's in the order of, let's say, 10 to 20 nanoamp. On the right hand, you can see the some different IV curves for different clamps, showing that, again, you can have sufficient performance of the device. The third and last example, which you could use as a local clamp, is in 0.13 SOI technology. On the top right hand, you had the GDNMOS devices, which we saw previously with all the variations, to show in the plot below that if you have a better ESD protection, you can make it reliable. I think there are about 6 or 7 measurements in this plot. And aside from a bit variation of the ohm resistance, and there's one with a bit higher VT1, but the current level at least is the same for all these devices. If you look at the left to the leakage, you see that this is simulation, that even for the worst case being the fast corner at 125 degrees, still the leakage is only 11 nanoamps. Now this one thing which we have omitted in this story, and that is the power clamp. And that comes back in all the different protection strategies. You always have to place some protection between VDD and ground. And again, in this case, a 22 nanometer SOI technologies, you can still make SCR-based solutions with really low leakage, both for 25 degrees and for high temperature, 125 degrees. If you would compare it to a rail clamp solution, you see for room temperature, it's still more or less reasonable, 18 nanoamps for a 0.8 volt rail clamp, 1.8 volt rail clamp with 100 nanoamps. But if you go to high temperature, the leakage is much higher, 6 microamp for the 0.8 volts. I don't have the exact number for the 1.8 volt, but still it's in the microamp range. So this concludes this presentation with the basic message. There are multiple ways to protect the IOs in the SOI technologies against ESD, all having some implication on leakage and signal voltage. But it should be possible in any case to keep the leakage low at a pad. Below 1 nanoamp is typically possible in the different SOI technologies. Thank you for your attention. You